Hi, my friend. Thank you for your time. And as everybody knows, we're back to where we were before. But I'll always love you, and I love you very much. Let you know that on camera.
Well, thank you, Zanny. I really appreciate that. And I've got to say, really enjoying the chance, first of all, to share some great brunch with you here.
Yeah.
Oakland, of course, is getting known more and more for our amazing food. And
that's
glad to
Frankie.
Share that
look
time
with you.
Look
at that counter back there, right?
Yeah.
And, like 50-ish, you know?
And it has been packed here all morning. People having a good time, having mm-hmm. some good food, mm-hmm. But also really appreciate our conversation as well.
Absolutely. Question about Prop 8. Briefly, what are your thoughts on the fact that it was declared unconstitutional?
I think this is a proud day for California. This is a proud day for everyone who values equal rights under the law. And the decision of the federal court was very clear that while it is legitimate to want to protect and help heterosexual families, that actually taking rights away from gay people doesn't do anything to advance those goals. And to me, this is a really important moment because there's a conversation that has been missing from this debate about marriage, which is to talk about what is really harming marriages and families in our society right now.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is true that families and straight families are struggling, rising divorce rates and other problems. And when we have an honest conversation about what's really causing that, let's be clear, the gay people are not causing the decline of
right.
straight families.
Right.
What is causing the decline of straight families? Foreclosures, divorce, abuse, neglect, but also some straight families are falling apart because one spouse is on their fifth tour of duty in Iraq.
Mm-hmm.
Some straight families are falling apart because one family member is in prison and that's destroying the family cohesion. Some families are falling apart because someone lost their job and mm-hmm. had to leave town to find employment. And so we have to be serious about protecting all of our families, and that requires us to be honest about what are the things that are causing the harm.
Right. Right. Now, Ninth Circuit Court's going to take up the issue of Prop 8. What do you think is going to happen?
Well, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeal is a very interesting court. It includes members of a wide range of the political spectrum, and when you appeal to the Ninth Circuit, you don't go in front of the whole court. You go in front of a chosen sample of judges from the Ninth Circuit. So once we learn which judges they'll be going to and when, we'll have a better sense of how that's likely to play out. But obviously, this may be going on for years.
Right. Now, shifting gears, you're running for mayor of Oakland?
Yes, sir.
And I have to ask you the same question I ask all the other candidates. What was the aha moment that made you decide you're going to run for mayor?
I'm running for mayor of Oakland because I believe we must prioritize rebuilding our economy and providing local jobs. I see that as absolutely essential to quality of life in our community, to public safety in our community, and to solving all of the other problems. We have a serious unemployment problem in Oakland. We have to make it a top priority of the administration in the coming years to create jobs and to ensure that those jobs are available to Oakland residents. That means everything from enforcing our local hire policies in a real way. It means working actively to attract projects, to attract investment, to attract new business, as well as to sustain the local businesses we have. It means local contracting policies. It means making it easier for businesses to get permits. It means things like my successful effort in the downtown rezoning to remove the onerous conditional use permit requirements from multiple categories of businesses so that businesses can open more easily.
Mm-hmm.
And we fundamentally have to rebuild our economy if we're ever going to have the resources, both for quality of life for the people in the community and the revenue to provide the government services that the public desires.
But what was the moment when you said, I'm going to run for mayor and I can do this? Because you've arguably been at large council member for just over a year plus, right? 2 years?
2 years.
Right. But when did you say, look, you know what, this isn't enough? Or did you? What happened?
Well, you know, I've been an elected official representing all the people of Oakland for 10 years,
mm-hmm.
first on the transit board and now on the city council. And prior to that, working with local government through my job as a legislative aide. And so I've been following the goings-on in Oakland policy for over a decade. And throughout the years, I've seen issues that I feel are not being sufficiently addressed, which I believe I bring a particular perspective to build for Oakland's future. For example, we don't have our business permits and licenses online.
Right.
Our information systems are still decades out of date. That impacts both public annoyance in terms of people trying to interact with government, get answers about everything from parking tickets to business licenses.
But I have to ask you, why did you, when did you say, I'm going to do this, doggone it? In other words, what was it that made you say, I'm going to do it? I mean, when was that? Everybody has a moment. You know, there's always something that happens that just either excites you, pisses you off, but makes you think, I can do better. When did that happen?
Well, it happened a few months ago. Certainly, I was following things for many years. And it was growing over the years, my sense that we have to plan for Oakland's future. We have to plan for Oakland's economic revitalization. But over my time being in City Hall, I have people call me about difficulties they're having in terms of getting answers, in terms of getting access to information, in terms of getting business licenses. And I've learned about other cities that have systems that are better and more advanced than ours, and our ongoing arguments about the importance of information and accessibility and working technology. And it finally became clear to me that if not me, who? You know, I did my undergraduate work at MIT.
So you got in there and said, you know what, this isn't enough. I can do it. Okay, I get
this needs to be done better. I did my undergraduate work at MIT. I've studied the workings of other cities that have better systems than we do, and I want to implement them here so that we can build our economic revival, so that we can build local jobs, so that we can make it easier to do business in the city of Oakland. And as over the course of the years, dealing with various people's concerns and issues around some of those difficulties, it's become clear to me that we have to have an assertive plan for our future that makes those kind of changes. And I see that if I don't step up and make sure those changes happen, that I otherwise could not be sure they will happen.
Also, I've talked to Parada, Gene Kwan, Don McClay, Greg Harper, Joe Tooman. Everyone has a different slight take on the police issue, but of all of the people I've talked to running for mayor this far, yours has been the most out there because during Oscar Grant you were protesting. Where do you stand with the police? How do you explain the budget issue and the cuts?
Absolutely. I voted no on the police layoffs. I voted against the police layoffs. And I want to say it is disgusting that the prison lobby sent out deceptive voters in which they said, you know, call the city council. And they listed four names. And they said, call these people to denounce them for laying off police. That mailer was sent after the vote, after I had voted no. And they sent out a mailer saying I had voted to lay off the police. That is disgusting. And the voters of Oakland deserve an honest debate about what we really need to do to secure our future. And a Sacramento interest group who lobbies for greater rates of incarceration when California already spends more imprisoning people than anywhere else in America is frankly not what Oakland voters need and not what the people of Oakland need and not how you secure our future. So let me explain why I voted no on the police layoffs. We have just lost 80 of our most recently trained, most recently recruited officers. They are some of our best and most effective. They've been trained in some of the newer methods, including compliance with the court order. And so losing our 80 newest officers is, in my opinion, a big mistake. We lost that investment of time and money we spent recruiting and training them. And also, because the youngest officers are the least expensive, we've also reduced force in the most inefficient way because we reduced it from the least expensive people. I believe the right approach would be to work with the police union to make a deal which would avert layoffs while having the pay into the pension, and that if after that is done, they said, well, what happens in a year if you still had to reduce force? Well, first of all, with attrition, you probably wouldn't have to. But second of all, let's deal with that. Even if you have to reduce force, it's better to reduce from the more expensive, more senior officers than to lay off the most junior officers. And so even paying a departure bonus or a retirement incentive, as people call them, is worth it financially because the more junior officers cost less. You could actually come out financially ahead even with a retirement incentive program for the more senior officers. And also that would let us preserve the time and money and investment we've made in recruiting and training these new people.
What do you think about the way the negotiations went with the police, where it seemed like rather than asking for the extra year, they just said, nah, 3 years, and they backed themselves, and so they got laid off. Can you give us some idea what the back channel conversations and what the council was thinking about that?
Well, what it seemed like from what I heard from back channels in an unofficial way is that there was actually disagreement amongst the police. That they were actually not necessarily all in agreement, but that maybe some of them were important to avoid the layoffs and some of them were maybe less excited about the pension pay-in strategy. So the sense I got, and then this is unofficial from different officers just making comments in an unofficial way, is that they weren't necessarily all in agreement about the right strategy, and that may also have contributed to why the negotiations didn't reach a resolution. But let me be clear, I absolutely believe that we can and should make that deal. And I know there will need to be more discussions about the exact deal points, but it is possible to have a pay-in which then pays for. People think by laying off 80 officers, we're saving the money of 80 officers. It's loss of the Measure Y money, which pays for about 60 officers. So in effect, we're losing 80, but we're saving the money of 20.
Tell my viewers who don't know what Measure Y is.
Measure Y was a Oakland ballot measure which passed several years ago, which provided funding for neighborhood beat police officers. And that money is only available if the city meets certain benchmarks. And so by laying off the number of officers that we did, we've triggered the loss of those benchmarks for getting that money.
How much are we talking about in terms of a loss?
We're talking about many millions of dollars of lost money. And so, in essence, we've laid off 80 police officers, but we're only saving between 20 and 25 officers worth of money for that substantial loss of force.
Now, shifting gears, A's, Raiders, and Warriors. As
yes.
mayor, that's part of your responsibility. What do you say about a new stadium for the A's?
I absolutely am committed to working with our professional sports teams on a real economic revival strategy. And you know, people talk a lot about why we lose money on our sports teams, and there's been a lot of finger pointing over the years. But when I actually research what happens in cities that do succeed financially with their sports teams, it turns out that what they're doing differently, they're not relying on just the sports team tickets to make money. The cities that are succeeding are doing so because they have put shops and bars and restaurants and hotels right at their sports venues, immediately right there. So you walk out the door of the Staples Center in LA, and right in front of you are bars and shops and restaurants and hotels. You don't need to get into a car to go to them. They're right there. And that's true at other sports venues throughout the country. If you look at ones that are succeeding, people come early to go out for dinner before, or they go out for drinks or dinner after a game. It creates a much more vibrant, exciting destination area, and it provides jobs and revenue both for the businesses themselves that would open there, but also revenue back to the city that funds the public services.
Now, we have two cities, San Jose and possibly San Francisco, if the new owner of the Warriors decides to move them. As mayor, would you do if you found out that San Jose, you know, is trying to take the A's?
Well, we just got some good news, which is that San Jose decided not to go to the ballot in November for voter authorization for their plan. And so this actually creates for us a window of opportunity.
Right, but the Major League Baseball said they're going to help them fund the next one next year. Which, to me, you know, we're still not out of the woods.
Oh, no, we're not out of the woods.
Okay.
We're not out of the woods. But what we've gotten is a window of opportunity. Because they're not on the election this ballot, it means there's some time between now and when any decision about San Jose could be made. And so I believe we have to harness this time window to work collaboratively with Major League Baseball and the sports franchises to come up with a viable plan in Oakland. And I believe that that viable plan needs to include a comprehensive development approach that has the amenities, the conference meeting facilities, the restaurants and bars and shops, so that we really are developing an entertainment destination that generates many jobs, lots of revenue, and that is a pleasant, fun, exciting place to go. You know, so right now when you get to the Coliseum and you walk that walkway from the bar station into the sports facilities, you know, let's just say it's not a welcoming experience. You know, it doesn't, we're not putting our best foot forward as a city. People who don't live in Oakland come to Oakland for a game, and what do they see? Barbed wire fence. You know, we're not putting our best foot forward. We're not generating the revenue. People come into our city and leave our city without dropping any money here because we didn't put any place there for them to spend their money. Mm-hmm. People come out of a game, they want to stop and have drinks or food with their friends. If we constructed our sports facilities in the right way with those amenities, it would be more fun to go to, and it would generate more jobs and more revenue.
What kind of mayor's office will you have?
I will have a mayor's office that is active and engaged and communicative, and that actively pursues jobs for Oakland residents and economic investment in our community.
We have a large staff, small staff. I mean, for example, you know, when I worked at Philly, we had 27 policy advisors, and you know, or will you have more like Jerry, lean it out, or will you rely on the city administrator's office? What are you doing there?
In light of the budget situation we're in now and the importance of everyone working together and of also being a role model around the struggles we're in, I would reduce the budget by 20% immediately out of the gate, including the salary, but also the overall budget, the total number of staff. I would cut that by 20% because of the situation we're in, and if I'm going to be asking other people to step up to the plate in this financial situation, I want to role model that sort of behavior. So I would absolutely implement those cuts, both for the salary and for the overall budget. However, let me be clear, we're in no way reducing the amount of tasks and work and effort we're putting in. We're going to have to be very effective and thoughtful and focused. We're going to specifically go out and recruit investment here. We're going to be pursuing funding for a wide range of projects, transit-oriented development, local street and road repair, as well is a priority, both because we should fix our streets and because the number of jobs that would create. And so we're going to be very active, very engaged, going to work collaboratively with the council as well as with other stakeholders throughout our city.
And finally, you are already the first lesbian to run for mayor of Oakland.
Yes.
Which means you'll be the first lesbian to be mayor of Oakland should you be elected.
Correct.
How has that impacted your campaign thus far? What does that mean to you?
Well, it's pretty interesting because Oakland is the city with the largest proportion of lesbian households in America. Mm-hmm. So the fact that I became Oakland's first lesbian elected official, you know, many years later, certainly than San Francisco had their first with Harvey Milk, you know, already it is kind of interesting. Mm-hmm. And it certainly has informed my view about the importance of working for justice and equality for all. But I also want to be clear, I'm running to be mayor of Oakland.
Right.
I'm not running to be mayor of Oakland's LGBT community. I'm running to be mayor of all of Oakland. And what's particularly powerful to me about the LGBT community in Oakland is that we live throughout the community. People don't live all in one neighborhood here. People are throughout Oakland. LGBT people in Oakland are in all walks of life, in all types of jobs and sectors. And so the vision of really revitalizing Oakland for all of us is absolutely compatible with that, including the LGBT community of Oakland.
How do they find you? What's your website?
My website is kaplanformayor.org.
Rebecca, it's a lot of fun. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Cool.